evening, everyone.
Good evening.
Make sure that if you can hear me or not hear me, is this okay? Everyone don't have to yell, so at least maintain voice. So it's good to have you be with you this evening. Happy Lent. We're in the throes of another season of grace, another season of growth, and all of those good things. So as our opening prayer, I just simply want to take us back for a moment to the first Sunday of Lent. Not too far back. This past Sunday we heard the gospel of the Transfiguration of the Lord, but always on the first Sunday of Lent every year, we always have one of the recountings of the Lord's temptation, led into the desert and so forth. And so we'll use that as our prayer, if that's okay, as we begin. And so let us pause just for a moment of silence. From the Gospel of Mark. The Spirit drove Jesus out into the desert, and he remained in the desert for 40 days, tempted by Satan. He was among wild beasts, and the angels ministered to him. After John had been arrested, Jesus came to Galilee proclaiming the gospel of God. This is the time of fulfillment. The kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe the gospel. So we pray, gracious Lord, that as we gather tonight, those words that call, that you proclaimed, may be our anthem of living in these days. Gracious God, give us the grace to recognize this time, this season, this opportunity to again seek to know you more closely, more intimately. Help us to continue to look into our own hearts, our lives, through these 40 days, that it may be a time of renewal, a time of grace, that we may see in ourselves those things that still need your healing touch. Open us. Help us to be open. Ask your healing love now and always. We make all these prayers through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
So we've got quite a task ahead of us. We've got probably at least a semester, if not two semesters worth of academic work to compact neatly into 1 hour. So I hope you've got your gym shoes on, because you're going to have to do a lot of running. My hope is to be imminently practical. That's my hope. You'll have to tell me at the end if I was successful or not. What I'm going to try and do is talk for the better part of an hour, because I want to respect schedules and that, but then entertain questions for a period of time when the pastor starts flicking the lights on and off, and know it's time to, it'll be time to go home. But practically speaking, I want to be as concrete as possible. Abstract concepts and thoughts are nice when you have time for debate and reflection and all of this kind of stuff. But what I want to present for you tonight is basically the mind of the church, the understanding of the church when it comes to the whole topic of the reality of the devil. One quick clarification, more times than not, when I talk about or refer to the devil tonight, I'm going to be using the words the evil one, just because that's just how I reference him. And for the simple fact that there's a variant translation of the Lord's Prayer, we commonly say, what's the last line, and deliver us from evil. But there's a variant translation of the Lord's Prayer that says, and deliver us from the evil one. And I think there's an advantage to that, as opposed to the kind concept of evil as something abstract, something general, you know, some amorphous cloud of information or reality. Evil, one, makes it personal, gives it personality and identity. And I believe that's in so many ways what we've lost over these years of understanding who the devil is, who the evil one is. It's a being. And again, that's the tradition of the church. Let me also preface by saying that I want to make a clear distinction between what is sin and what is the devil. They are not the same thing. Sin is born of our own choices. We all have free will, right? We choose the right, we choose the wrong, but we're free to do that. It's the world in which you're born, a broken world, but for the grace of God, through sacraments, sacramental living, baptism, all those kinds of things, we can rise above it with the help of God, the reality of sin. The devil is a distinct being. And again, contrary to what sometimes, you know, lots of bad information out there. I know lots of folks want to look to, you know, the internet and Hollywood and even a very variety of authors as the purveyors of truth. You know, these are the definitive words of all of these kinds of things. You know, I have to disappoint you, but you know, the internet is not always the best source of truth or clarity or understanding. And so I stand here as a Catholic priest, sharing with you what is the tradition of the church, what has been the tradition of the church down through the centuries. And so, bearing in mind, there's the reality of sin, but then there's the devil himself. The devil is not responsible for all that is wrong in the world. We need to keep a healthy balance. The church always draws us to walk in virtue. Virtue stands in the middle between extremes. Many times, in many places, it seems like we're living from one extreme as the devil doesn't exist at all. You know, that's something that was dreamed up in the Middle Ages and, you know, people have used it over the years to torture kids or to keep people in line or whatever, you know. I know none of you are old enough, but some may recall laughing. Remember laughing in the comedy show? You know, the devil made me do it kind of thing. But there's, you know, there's the extremes. He doesn't exist at all. Or is responsible for everything. Everything that's wrong in the world. Everything that happens that's evil. But as always, follow that logic through. If he's responsible, if the devil is responsible for everything, what do I have to be responsible for? Nada. Nothing. The church calls us, again, to walk a middle ground. The devil does exist. We just heard in Scripture, we'll hear furthermore passages in Scripture. The devil exists. He came nose to nose with the Son of God. He's a creature. He has a beginning. He is not God. Fallen angel. He exists. Is he responsible for everything? No. He isn't all that, even though he may think he is. He is a creature. He has distinct privileges as a creature. But he has limitations too, because he is not God. And we need to be very clear about that. We stand in the middle. Our tradition stands in the middle. Yes, he exists. But he's only able to do so much. So in the course of this hour, I want to kind of hang my comments on three movements, if you will. You know, a clear understanding of our Catholic tradition, we're going to be fine. Second, to know how the adversary, the evil one, works. What does he look like in real time? How does he interact in most people's lives? And thirdly, how do we respond? Simple kinds of things, okay? It gives us kind of a little bit of a roadmap to get us through for this next period of time. So far, so good. Most eyes are still open. That's encouraging. I don't hear any snoring. That's good. So I want to spend the first bit of time talking about different things. First, I'm going to use scripture. Then I'm going to use the catechism. I'm going to use two portions of scripture, then the catechism of the Catholic Church, and then a talk that Blessed Pope Paul VI gave back in 1972. Scripture. Why do we start? Because what do we know? What does the Church teach us about the evil one? What's the nature of the evil one? We're going to look at the other two Gospels that we did hear this first Sunday of Lent. We heard Mark. We're in the season of Mark. This year, the Gospel is all Mark. Until we get to the summer, we get to John for a bit, but it's all Mark. Mark is to the point, succinct, no fluff. And that's why we have the Gospel that I just read. What do we hear? The Spirit drove Jesus into the desert. He remained there for 40 days, tempted by Satan. Period. That's not a lot of help. You know? But it speaks to the reality. He was tempted by Satan. The presumption of Scripture, the teaching that we find from Scripture, is the evil one exists. Satan is real. He comes to confront the Lord. But if we look at the two other Gospels that run alongside Mark, that provide the same passage, if you will, slightly expanded, Matthew and Luke, we hear more detailed. We hear more detailed piece of temptation, of the reality. In all three of those Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, what do? We see that evil one is bold. He's arrogant. He comes right up into the face of the Lord. Got no problem doing that. The creature standing before God himself. So it's a humbling thing for all of us to think if we can outdo or outsmart the evil one on a one-to-one basis all by ourselves. The Lord can. We cannot. But the evil one is so arrogant. And if you think that if he will go into the presence of the Lord and not come after us, there's a learning curve there. He's arrogant. He's proud. He's not afraid to engage if given the opportunity. And that's what's key. That's the first piece. The second piece we learn from these passages about another quality, another part of the nature of the evil one, is that his knowledge is not perfect. We don't see that in the Gospel from Luke or from Mark that we just heard, but if you look at Matthew and if you look at Luke, how does the evil one pose the three questions or the three statements of the question? How does he pose them to the Lord? What word does he begin with in all those cases? If you are the Son of God, pick up this bread. You're hungry. Pick up the stone, I'm sorry. You're hungry, make it bread. Make it food, feed yourself. If you are the Son of God, takes him up to the parapet of the temple, throw yourself off. Angels will certainly scoop you up. God's not going to let anything happen to you if you are the Son of God. The evil one does not know definitively that Jesus is God. His knowledge is not perfect. In his arrogance, in his pride, he thinks he's all that. But he ain't. He's testing. He tests. If you are the Son of God. Yes, are you? Are you? Prove it. The Lord doesn't need to prove anything. The Son of God doesn't need to prove anything. Interestingly, what's key is the response. The evil one puts these statements to the Lord. How does the Lord respond? What does he use? He uses scripture. He uses God's word. In reply, he, as the Son of God, could certainly reply very comfortably on his own as the Son of God. What does he choose to do? He chooses to use sacred scripture. It also gives us insight, key insight into the power of the Word of God. That the eternal Son himself uses the Word to confront darkness, to confront the evil one, the power of the Word of God. Something for all of us to be attentive to live in and to visit regularly God's sacred Word. The evil one gets it. The evil one is the legalist par excellence. St. Augustine wonderfully said about him, the dog's on a leash. He's on a leash because he's a creature, because he's not God. What happens when the dog's on a leash? Well, he can run, right? But only so far. A little practical wisdom. Don't you know, enjoying it from you, if you've ever had or ever encountered a mean or ferocious dog? Stay outside of the length of the chain, the circle of the chain. Are you safe? Yeah? What happens when you come up to where the chain, to the extent where the chain extends? Is there a chance you might get nipped? What happens if you're foolish enough to step inside the length of the chain? You're going to get bit. Simple image, practical image, but it's the truth. The person living the life of grace, the ordinary life of grace, sacrament, you start here, you're centered there. I can assure you, if you are trying to do your best to live with him as the center of your life, rare are the problems you're going to have. It's not a get-out-of-jail-free card. We all know what life is and the struggles of life and faith and all of those kinds of things. But if I'm doing my best to keep myself centered on the person of Jesus Christ, very difficult for the evil one to wiggle his way in. Again, there's no 100%, but in very broad terms. Majority of times, if I'm living a life of grace, if I'm setting myself on Christ, if I'm receiving the sacraments, if I have a prayer life, Eucharistic adoration, devotions, reading scripture, do good works, I'm pretty unappealing to the evil one because I'm covered with God's grace. I'm living in communion with the eternal Son of God. Something to keep coming back to and keep focusing on. So we've got Matthew and Luke that are helping us to kind of put flesh on Mark's bones in the sense of understanding the nature of the evil one. How does the evil one function? We look to John chapter 8, verse 44. I'm just going to summarize, if you will, that passage. What do we learn? We learn two things. Jesus is talking about Satan, and he says he's a murderer from the beginning. Should we go back to Eden? Can we go back to Eden? Go back to the garden? What took place there? We've got Adam, we've got Eve, we've got the serpent. Murderer from the beginning. He's a liar. That's the second part of that same statement. He's a liar and he's the father of lies. Remember that encounter? We're going to keep making that, but you're so close. So you do that. You're right here. You say, I'm moving. You know, get me away from this crazy man. Because it's nice walking. What happens in Eden? You know, they're placed there, which is essential to remember too. Our parents, our first parents, Adam and Eve, already knew what it was like to be in paradise. They started there. So they already had in their understanding what it was humanity, free will, choose. Of course, what immediately starts, and we see it so often in sin, is the blame game, right?
Yeah.
What happens immediately? Well, God comes walking in the cool of the evening. No Adam need to be found anywhere. Where are you? Hello? Hello? We hit ourselves. Why? Because we were naked. How'd you know you were naked? You ate from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, the tree that they weren't supposed to eat. Huh? You did that. And you know, the first look is, well, she made me do it. It doesn't stop there. Eve, the little long slithering thing, he made me do it. The blame game. Doesn't it always enter in so quickly? Because what is not taking place? They're not taking responsibility for their actions. It's somebody else's fault. We live in a society like that now. You know, if I only had better parents, if I only had better teachers, if I only lived in a better neighborhood, if I only, all of the reasons, it's somebody else's fault and somebody else should do something about that. Me? No. Loss of personal responsibility is key in all of this. And the kicker is, and that's why the second part of that same passage, right, is murder from the beginning. The sad thing is, yeah, what happened as a result? No, you're not going to die. We don't. What entered the world as a result of that choice? Death. The lie. Right from the beginning, he's a liar, he's the father of lies. Sadly, it's not just physical death, because we know that if we die, physical death, apart from God, it's an eternal death. He's a murderer from the beginning. He's a liar and the father of lies. It's how he functions. There's no physical description of the evil one anywhere in Scripture. It's how he functions. It's how he manifests himself. So then let's shift quickly. So we've talked about the nature of the evil one, especially Matthew and Luke. We've talked about how he functions, John's Gospel. Now I just want to tap briefly from our tradition, namely the Catechism of the Catholic Church. If you want the cliff note description of basically the Church's understanding of who the evil one is, open up your Catechism of the Catholic Church, take that book off the shelf, blow the dust off that baby, and crack her open to numbers 391 to 395. The Catechism is arranged by numbers, paragraphs. So 391 to 395 gives you the Church's understanding from the beginning of who the evil one is. And I'm going to just briefly quote number 391. Behind the disobedient choice of our first parents lurks a seductive voice. Oh, come on. Just a piece of fruit. Opposed to God, which makes them fall into death out of envy. But you won't die, you'll become like God. Scripture and the Church's tradition see in this being a fallen angel called Satan, or the devil. The Church teaches that Satan was at first a good angel, made by God. God can only create good. The Church teaches that Satan was at first a good angel, made by God. The devil and the other demons were created by God naturally good, but they became evil out of their own doing. Choice. Pure spirits, God created angels, angelic beings, pure spirits first. They always, like us, had free will to choose. The fall that takes place in paradise had already taken place. I mean, what takes place, the fall that took place in Eden, in the physical, had already taken place in the heavenly. The fall of the angels. It simply is mirrored in the fall of Adam and Eve. Again, we just keep building, bit by bit, to kind of put a face on how the evil one functions, how he exists. Now we're going to step to November 15th, 1972. Blessed Pope, I think later this year, to be Saint Pope Paul VI, right? Is it October? Thank you, I didn't know that. I know it was later this year that Paul VI would be canonized. The Pope Francis, when he joked, or he jokingly, when he made this announcement, said that he invented understanding of the wings. Because I mean, how many have been canonized? We've canonized John XXIII, and St. John Paul II, and now better, Paul VI, so they said they're waiting in the wings. Yeah, he may get his day too. I don't think so. Anybody that was Pope, even if he lasted only 33 days, I mean, he deserves something. Anyway, so November 15th, 1972, over a series of Wednesday audiences, which Pope Francis still does, they usually give some kind of instruction. You know, people either gather in the piazza outside of St. Peter's or in the Pope Paul VI audience hall. And so for a series of Wednesdays, Blessed Paul VI, was parsing the Lord's Prayer, giving context. He was parsing first week, she started like in late September, Our Father, and he spoke on that. The following week, who art in heaven, and so forth and so on. He arrives on November 15th, 1972, and he gets to the line, and deliver us from evil, the last line. Allow me just to excerpt briefly that talk. He begins by saying, what are the church's greatest needs at the present time? Don't be surprised at our answer, and don't write it off as simplistic or even superstitious. One of the church's greatest needs is to be defended against the evil we call the devil. This is 1972. A little bit later, Blessed Paul continues. We come face to face with sin, which is a perversion of human freedom. That's what sin is. You know, sometimes you think, oh, I'm free, I'm going to do whatever I want to, and I sin. And that's freeing me. It's binding me. I'm being bound by sin. And the profound cause of death, because it involves what? Detachment from God, the source of life. And then sin, in its turn, becomes the occasion and the effect of an interference. Wonderful little word, interference. We just heard in number 391 of the Catechism of the Catholic Church, a seductive voice. And somebody just kind of is there just to kind of tap us on the shoulder, just to whisper. Just nothing overt, nothing, hey, look at me. Just that the subtlety about it. Here's that interference. Now I know you all are too young, especially you. But a few of us might recall in having a radio when there was a time when you couldn't just push a button and it would go to the station digitally. I know none of you recall that, I'm sure. Trust me, take my word on this. You would have to tune in, right? What was the stuff in between the stations? What do we call that? Somebody must have told you that. You looked that up on YouTube or something. I know you did. Static. The stuff in between. The stuff in between hitting the mark, hitting the channel, being tuned in. A seductive voice. An interference. Static. White noise. Just simple good ways of imaging who the evil Francis was elected, even a few months leading after. I mean, he was doing, like, continuing to do things that befuddled certainly the media and other folks. But regularly, from the beginning of his pontificate, he talked about the devil very comfortably. Yeah, he's in the course of his conversations, in the course of his talks, in the course of his preaching, he talks about the devil. And the media would mystify. What is he going to hang up with the devil? He's going to cure some kind of, curiosity about the devil. Why is he always talking about the devil? We don't know the devil, we don't think he exists anymore. Why is he talking about him? And yet, if you listen to all of his talks, all of the context, he puts the devil in a proper perspective. He's a player. He's on the scene. He's part of the landscape. He's part of creation. He's there. But then, of course, the Holy Father always brings us right back to Jesus Christ. You've got to know who's out there. You've got to know who the players are. You have to know. But I firmly believe the vast majority of folks that are living the ordinary life of grace, all that list of things, some of our sacraments, prayer, all those kinds of things, I believe that we bump up against the evil one on a regular basis. And we don't even know what we do because we're not looking at him and we're not looking for him. We're looking at him. And that's exactly where we should be looking. If we're focused, if we're centered in the person of Jesus Christ, does it mean the evil one is taken off the map and it disappears? No, he's still there. And he's going to be there until the final consummation, until the end of the world. But it doesn't matter. It's when people become focused and fixated and curious and open themselves up to the darkness that they've got a problem. And so that's where I want to segue now. So we've been talking, generally speaking, about some of the historical, the traditional view, the church's mind of who the evil one is. One of the things about the evil one, and in his attempt to set up his own kingdom, we see as a result of the fall from grace, is he wanted to be God. There's the envy, the pride. Why am I not God? I shouldn't be God. Lucifer was the brightest of the angels, we read through our tradition. The light bearer. He fell from the loftiest place to the lowest. And so he wants to establish, and attempts to establish his own kingdom. Again, all of this is found within our catechism of the Catholic Church. Again, in some ways, none of this should be even new. This is who we are as a Catholic Church, our understanding of the nature of the kingdom. And so in wanting to set up a kingdom, he wants to do what God does, although he wants to turn it upside down. He wants to invert it. He wants to create the negative version of the positive. How do we get to heaven? This is your chance. Make your pastor proud. Come on. He's taking notes of names, by the way. Except the Lord. What does that mean?
Take him as your savior.
But in real time, okay, that's a declaration of faith. But is it a do it once for all and you're good? What does it look like in real time? Tell me if I'm putting words in your mouth, you can just shut me down. But in a sense, it's a day in, a day out kind of thing. continually committing and recommitting ourselves to the Lord. And we do this how? And we were talking about earlier, sacramental living, life of grace, prayer, devotions, stations of the cross, Divine Mercy Chaplet, the Rosary, Scripture, all those kinds of things. What's the end game? What's the hope? Go home, to leave all this other stuff behind, to go to glory, absolutely. relationship, and that's what it's all about. We establish a relationship with the Lord, don't we? And all of those things help us to grow in deepening of that love relationship with the Lord. The same list, sacraments, prayer, all those kinds of things, and in paradise. We establish a relationship with God, and we do our best to live that relationship on a daily basis. And like, if it's a real relationship, if it's a healthy relationship, it's going to have its ups and downs. It's not going to be a smooth ride. You're going to say, me, some, no doubt some days we want to take the Lord on our shoulders and say, what are you doing? Yeah, because somehow we've got it all figured out. The Lord's the one that's not getting it, right? But it's not a perfect relationship. God is perfect, and he's calling us into holiness and perfection, and we're trying to be changed. We're trying to become holy. It's a lifelong work and relationship. The evil one tries to do the same thing. To be drawn into a relationship. Our regular encounters, if you will, with the evil one, or at least the normal struggles of human living, is temptation. I'm tempted. God's grace is always there. Do I respond to the grace, or do I choose and sin? If I sin, how do I remedy that? Confession, sacrament of reconciliation, I heal that. But if I fall away, if I choose, you know, in a sense, to keep walking down or walking away from the Lord, then something else can happen. I oftentimes talk about, and there's many, I'm just going to talk about a handful of them, of doorways. It's just a way of imaging it. I open up a doorway. You can open up that church door 100 different times, many different times. Does that mean somebody's going to walk through it or someone's going to walk through it? Possibly. It's an open door. Leave the front door of your house open, depending on where you're living. But even so, things may walk in, things may not. But we have to be very careful when we open doorways. What may come in, right?
Yeah.
Same is true in this whole engagement. The evil one is looking to be in a relationship with us. He's looking for that invitation. Again, if I'm living a life of grace, if I'm very content and focused, and I'm not opening doorways, by and large, I have nothing to worry about. But what happens if I open those doorways? Any number of people have their own lists of doorways. I'm going to talk primarily about four. These are not guarantees that the evil one is definitely going to walk in and set up shop. But they can be the condition for the possibility that the evil one may try to engage. And depending upon how often I open that doorway, is the potential for that relationship to develop. Huh? Fair? So far, so good? You're still nodding. That's not because you're sleeping. That's good. Four doorways. Here are the first one. Here they are. First is a pattern of sin. I'm not talking about a habit of sin. That's somewhat different. Father Joe is a very fine moral theologian. At some point, he can make the distinction between a pattern of sin as opposed to a habit of sin. I'm talking about a pattern of sin. In other words, a particular sin, choose your favorite sin. I don't want to hear them. Just in your own mind, just choose it. Just think about it. Again, I fall into the habit, or I fall into the practice of that sin. First, you know, because, you know, I'm attentive to it, and I nip it in the bud, I stop. Or if I do fall into it, I go to confession, I receive sacramental grace, penance, absolution, and I start over again. Because it's easy to fall. Everybody falls. It's the easiest thing to do in the world is to fall. Gotta get back up. Right? You gotta start again. That's the life of grace, of redemption, starting over again and again and again. But what happens when that particular sinner group, cluster of sins, whatever, becomes a pattern? and I keep falling into it. And as I'm falling into those sins, the practice of grace, of responding to that, begins to break down. My relationship with God begins to break down. And I'm starting to focus more on the sin than the opportunities of grace, of healing, of restoration, of renewal. And that can snowball. The sin, the sin, the sin. It creates the condition for the possibility. It creates a fertile ground for possibly the evil one to engage, to enter into relationship. The evil one always needs a hook to hang his hat on. He just can't say, oh, this is a lovely space, I'm going to move in and set up housekeeping. Not if you're living the life of grace. It doesn't happen. It doesn't work that way. There has to be a hook for him to hang his hat on. We can always be reflecting in our lives, am I giving him any of those hooks in my life to hang, to allow him to hang his hat on? Very important. So, a pattern of sin. The second, which these first two probably are the most obvious, the second is direct occult activity. I'm engaging the occult. I'm going to some cultic practice. I'm, going to a medium, or I'm going to a tarot card reader, or I'm going to, in different cultures. I'm going to a botanica. I'm going to a brujo, a witch, a warlock. I'm going to a healer. I'm going to some kind of person that does some kind of work, cleansings, all of these kinds of things. These can very easily become a replacement for faith. Instead of continuing to trust in God and in God's providence, it's very easy to set aside that and say, well, I've got someone that can give me a line of information, that can give me some data, that can give me some input. What is that? And you think, oh, for gosh sakes, it's 2018. Who goes to tarot card readers and plays with a Ouija board and consults this or goes to a healer or all these kinds of things? You'd be amazed how many people. What we're experiencing, and not only in this culture, not only in our American society, but in so many places, at least I can only speak for parts of the English-speaking world that I've had the honor of being able to either participate or work or teach, whatever the case may be. I'm talking about South Africa, I'm talking about Australia, I'm talking about the Philippines and other places. Two things have happened. The first one, more so in our country than the other countries I just mentioned, is that we've become desensitized. And on an increasing level, we become desensitized. Our views, our approach to things, our cultural milieu. Look at the evening programming. Count up. And actually, I've got a priest friend that really regularly keeps tally of these kinds of things. The numbers of shows about zombies, warlocks, witches, vampires, all sorts of different kinds of things. In and of itself, is a program about one of these topics harmful? I don't mean to disappoint you, but probably not. But if that's all you're focusing on, if that's all you're drawn into, shows about, paranormal activity, the ghost hunters, the ghost busting, those who dabble in black magic, the occults, all of these kinds of things. And our society is imbued with it. Coupled with a society where I've got my rights, right? I can do whatever I want and nobody dare step on my rights. A loss of moral objectivity. All of these things erode away the truth. Truth. It erodes away our understanding. We give way and say, oh, well, it's just, it's not so bad. It could be something else. It could be, but it gets heaped layer upon layer upon layer. After a while, we're so far removed. And I hardly consider myself. You know, prude, trust me. I grew up in a farmer family and had a tavern in the family. So I grew up behind the bar. Before I was old enough to look over the bar, I was behind the bar. There's someone here that can attest to that, and she has to keep her mouth shut. You know, so, but it, you look at our evening program just in general, in the sense of just, you know, the eroding away of just, you know, what is solid things, moral things? That's one piece of it. The other is we are becoming increasingly, rapidly increasingly syncretistic. There's a syncretism. There's synergy. There's, you know, that we, the best way I can describe it is we have a hold of the hand of the church with one hand, and then we're holding on to a whole lot of other things, esoteric practices with the other. You know, it's kind of like, oh, both hand, I want to walk hand in hand with all of this kind of stuff, as opposed to making a definitive stance to say, I was baptized Christian, I am a Catholic, I stand with Jesus Christ. You know, I want to be able to go off to, you know, for a cleansing, or I want to, you know, go off and, you know, have my cards read, or I want to, you know, whatever the case may be. What does that do? It divides the heart. We no longer are, what is it, less than our single heart, less than our those who have set their focus on Jesus Christ. And this all happens gradually. It's not just one thing where we go to bed at night and we wake up the next morning and it's all there. This happens over time. So let me talk briefly about that. So we've talked about a pattern of sin. We've talked about a cult, engaging the occult. The third, and where a whole lot of folks, without sometimes realizing it, provide rich soil for the evil one to come in and hang his hat. And it's either trauma or abuse. Trauma, somebody witnesses something, a horrific accident, suicide, a homicide, something that, that truly traumatizes them to the core, it's something they witness, or they're exposed to outside of themselves. The other side, or the other portion of that is abuse, that something they themselves experience. Physical abuse, verbal abuse, psychological abuse, emotional abuse, sexual abuse. And, of course, the greater the extent, the deeper the wounding. A wound takes place within the person. Trauma can cause it. Abuse can cause it. There's a wounding within the heart of the person. What's the hope? Well, the hope is that the person will receive supportive care, therapy, spiritual direction, and with time, God willing, will heal. There's no eraser for that. There's nothing that's going to make that go away. You learn how to live with it, and you learn how to move forward. Look at the things that happen within family systems, family structures, the abuse that can happen, different horrific kinds of things, spousal abuse, sexual abuse, so many different kinds of things. What does that do to the person? What does that strip away from them? Their dignity, their self-worth, a whole host of things. And if the person is not able to move forward into healing, there's a very good possibility that they spend their days living in all of the negative emotions. Anger, resentment, rage, retaliation, bitterness, a whole host of things. And that's exactly where the darkness wants the person to stay. Because you stay in that state, you're not living. You're not moving forward. You're not opening yourself up to God's life, to God's love, to God's grace. And you've got, you know, some seductive whispering voice saying, yeah, that's your God. God, it's the God who you say loves you. Yeah. If your God loved you, would he allow that to happen? Yeah. So much for your God. And it continues to make the wounding more deep and more corroded and more corrupted. nice, fertile soil in which to enter into a relationship with Jesus. The invitation. I'll help you with your pain. I'll help you to, I'll help to distract you. I'll help to make you feel better. Yeah, exactly. The fourth is what I call unforgiveness. Certainly as a confessor, and without putting Father Joe on the spot, certainly we spend a lot of time talking with people. One of the issues that comes up is the inability to forgive. I can't forgive. I can't move. I'm stuck in this place. This person did whatever they did. It's not unlike some of the same emotions and feelings that go along with the categories of trauma and abuse, but that same kind of sense of being stuck. I can't move forward. I've got, if you ever visit me, wherever I'm located, for many years now, I've got this little statue. I mean, I don't mean to scandalize, at least minimally, only. You come to my office, you'll see the usual appointment you'd expect, an image of the crucified, an image of Our Lady, Saint Raymond Pettiford. In case you don't know, Raymond Pettiford is the patron saint of canon lawyers. And trust me, canon lawyers need a patron saint. So that's right, St. Raymond. And there's also an image that stands yay big. And it's an image of Jacob Marley. Call the name Jacob Marley. Have you ever seen the movie Christmas Carol? Or the book, read the book Christmas Carol? Jacob Marley is Scrooge's business partner, if you remember. And Jacob Marley is the one that shows up at the beginning of the movie to warn poor Ebenezer that he's going to have three visitors, ghosts of Christmas past, present, and future. How does Jacob Marley show up? He's in chains. And that's exactly what this wonderful, Jim Shore is the artist. You may have seen things by Jim Shore. This wonderful little image, there stands Jacob Marley, gray suit, the mouth closed, got a towel around the mouth as he used to do in death to keep the mouth shut, eyes standing there, and he's covered with chains. Real chains. I mean, you know, if I'm in a particularly boring phone conversation, I'll play with chains. No, I'm just joking. Jacob Marley, at least for me, I offer for you in this Lenten season, Jacob Marley for me is a mirror. I look at Jacob Marley every day, pretty much. And I ask myself, what are the things that I have chained myself with? What are the things that I have bound myself with? Grudges, bitterness, resentment, retaliation. All of the things that I can bind, and perhaps you can bind yourself with. No one's holding a gun to my head saying, Jeffrey, you cannot set those things down. You must carry them through with you for the rest of your life. You must bind yourself by these things. Absolutely not, because God wants us to be free. God wants us to live his life of love and freedom. But there's a good chance, if you sit and reflect deeply within yourself, there's a good chance that you may well find something within your own heart. Perhaps. I'm not calling anyone out. I'm not asking for public confessions. But are there things in your own lives that you bound yourself to or by? Things, I mean, and sometimes stuff that goes back so many years, things that may have happened to you as a child, as a young adult, things that were done to you, and they may be horrific. I'm not trying to take away anything. But I'm challenging you to work with it and to heal it. And stop carrying it with you. To be free, that's what God envisions us. And it also does not give the evil one something to hold on to. Set it down. For however many years you've been dragging it with you, binding yourself by it, set it down. Let God enter into that, to heal you to the core, to be truly free, because that's what God wants for you. So these are just some of the ways that the darkness engages us. He's looking for those doorways, and there are others. People will talk about generational things that have been passed down. There's one school of thought that in certain cases, the evil one will set his sight on someone and try to wear them down. You see it even in the lives of the saints. Look at poor Padre Pio, look at John Vianney, look at Teresa of Avila, Mother Teresa. Horrific things in the lives of the saints where the darkness set their sights on. You think, what? They should be where they're saints. But in certain situations, God permits that to help them to grow, to even deepen further their holiness. But the evil one is there. He's a player. He's on the landscape, part of the fixtures, if you will. But as always, I take you back to Jesus Christ, because he must be the center of your life. It's not a get-out-of-jail-free card. But if you have a clear focus, if you have a clear trajectory of whom you're serving and with whom you are in love, like any other relationship, I'm sure no doubt the couples in here that can say that they've never had a harsh word with their spouse. They've always done everything they've been asked to do, right? I can see all the nodding heads. Yeah, sure. Because that's life. That's life. But if our vision's clear and pure, and we're working at it, that was the most wonderful thing. Periodically, the late, great Archbishop Sheen gets as they're especially trying to bring his earthly remains back from New York to his own home diocese of Peoria. But he was interviewed. I mean, this is the great broadcast man, Archbishop Sheen. I know some of you are young enough and you say, who's Archbishop Sheen? Just trust me, he's on his way to canonization. As interviewers have a tendency to do, they kind of, well, even in his day, maybe they show the mic in his face and mouth. And they said, the person asked, Archbishop Sheen, you've had all these wonderful accomplishments. This was later in his life. You had the various TV program, and the great preacher, all of the good things he did. And the interviewer said, what do you want to be remembered for? Of all of that list of things, what do you want to be remembered for? Archbishop Sheen, without missing a note, said, I want to be remembered that I died. And isn't that what it's all about? Simple response. I died trying. I died trying to love the Lord. I died trying to follow him. I died trying to do my best. I died trying. Not how wonderful I was, how successful I was. Because what can enter into all of that? The same thing that took Lucifer. Pride. Have a humble heart. I died trying. What a wonderful guest in your house.
And we need to leave you, children.
Okay, so if people need to leave, watch the whole place empty out. just kidding. Please, I want to respect that. I apologize. Like I said, we're going to try to condense several semesters of stuff into an hour. So this thing kind of skipped along with the highlights in a sense. And at least, hopefully, a couple things have happened. A, you at least have a clearer understanding, I hope, from Scripture, from the catechism, from tradition. You have a clear understanding of the church's mind, the church's understanding of who the evil one is, and he's real. He's part of our tradition. He's not God. He's a creature, first and foremost. How to look for him, to reflect within your own heart, in prayer, in the sacraments. Am I giving the evil one any doorways in which to come into my life? And clue you in on something. Even in genuine cases of demonic possession, and we get a lot of buzz, everybody likes to talk about exorcists and demonic sensationalism that goes along with it. But in those real cases, when that reality happens, at the end of the day, it is still the person, him or herself, who has to close the doorway that they opened. No one else can do that for them because it's about free will. We always have our free will. And that's so important to remember. I firmly believe that the church developed the rite of exorcism in her wisdom and her love for her children to assist those who had advanced that relationship with the darkness so far that they don't have the strength anymore to close the door by themselves. And so they have the ministry, the love of the church to help them. And the rite of exorcism takes them to a point and helps to strengthen them and to get them to be able to finally close the door. So just a balance of things. So with that, questions? Drink some water. Anything. If I can't answer it, Father Joe will. He was always smarter than me anyway. Anything. It's a quiet group. Why is this helpful? Be honest, you don't have to be nice. I'm going back to Homewood Park where we finished, so you don't have to be nice. I mean, be honest. I mean, in the sense of substance-wise. Are there questions as a result, please?
Well, I was just thinking about when we pray the Our Father, that would become part of our daily exam, and I need the Lord to set me free from any of these attachments.
Yeah, absolutely. And even that sense of, I mean, I realize, I mean, we have the standard model that we use, or form of the Lord's Prayer, where we say, deliver us from evil. But in the back of your mind, even when you pray the Lord's Prayer, that sense of, to deliver us from the evil one. I mean, because anything, because we've lost that sense, and that's exactly what Pope Paul VI was trying to get at, and that, and in fact, I didn't even finish the quote. Let me go back to just for a second, because I think Pope Paul VI, in 1972, he hit the nail right on the head. Because if you finish that a little further on in that quote, he talks about the perversion of freedom and the interference. But in the next paragraph, this is what Paul says. Evil is not merely an absence of something. Because Thomas Aquinas, that's how Thomas Aquinas defined evil. He defined evil as the absence of good. If the good is absent, then there's evil. Simple way to understand or to define those terms. But Blessed Paul VI is building on that understanding, and he's saying evil is not merely an absence of something, but an active force, a living spiritual being that is perverted and that perverts. See, and that's what we've lost. You know, that sense of the person, we've taken evil in kind of this abstract concept. Well, there's evil in the world. No kidding. You know, I mean, there's a real revelation. There's evil in the world. Yeah, okay, let me turn on the TV or the radio or my smartphone or whatever the case, whatever I'm using. And sadly, because people talk, you know, look at the world, look at Syria, look at the Middle East, look at Chicago. Look at our city streets. Look at what happens in family homes. Look at what happened in Parkland, Florida. What happened to Commander Bauer a couple of weeks ago. Look at the violence. Look at all the horrible things. Yeah, it's evil. And usually the response on the heels there is somebody should do something about that. They should. I mean, if we had a better mayor, better governor, better parents, somebody should fix that. And no claim to responsibility. Pope Paul VI, already in 1972, was trying to bring the church back to center, to say that this is a personal reality. He comes to us personally. He's looking sadly, I mean, and even that's a challenge even for the priest. You have to say, you know, Mass daily, or you say multiple Masses on a weekend, and you just kind of go through the motions. Shame on any of us that do. I only speak for myself, you know. But I mean, we're holding in our hands, you know, eternal Son of God. If we are not attentive to that, if we are distracted, if we are whatever, we have to continually be calling ourselves back to, and each of us, in our vocation as a Christian, as you know, as a person that's supposed to bear Christ. It's easy to talk the talk, right? But it is then a challenge, absolutely. How do we make ourselves? How do we keep ourselves fresh? You know, all of that, especially when it comes to prayer. Amen. Yes.
I have a question. You said that if we're, you know, living in a life of grace and focused on Jesus, then we, you know, won't really get attention from the devil. When I'm involved, like in women's retreats, you know, as we get closer to the date, sometimes lots of things start to go crazy, and it's who we give credit to. We always say, you know, just focus on Jesus, and devil's kicking up his heels, but we'll just, you know, focus on Jesus, and he's trying to, you know, divert us, distract us, and often to the participants that have like a newfound energized faith will say, you know, don't get discouraged when things get in your way because he's going to try to distract you from that. So I guess I just kind of looked at that as being, you know, if we're trying to strive for Jesus, keep our eyes on him, then we won't attract attention. But
no, you know. I mean, it does happen. It happens regularly. I mean, anybody that's trying to grow in holiness, you know, I mean, if there's any way he can frustrate or he can challenge or he can get in the way. But I mean, what it is in so many ways, though more times than not, it works against him because people are struggling and committing themselves more deeply, you know. But it is, I mean, it's how he works, you know. And like I said, I mean, it's not absolute. If I'm entirely focused on Jesus, I'm not going to have those run-ins or those encounters. He's a player. He's a bully. He's a thug. I mean, those are some of the nicest things I can say about him. You know, I mean, the two best manifestations of the darkness, of the evil one, first is fear. He lives in fear. He loves fear. And that's how he manifests most profoundly, is because what happens when we're fearful? We're off balance. We're other places. But he's masterful at parlor tricks, causing things to break down, causing complications, causing all kinds of different things, so as to primarily, you know, if the temperatures are changing, if the lights are going on and off, if this is happening, if that is happening, it instills fear. Mm-hmm. And that's where he wants us to be because we become disoriented. Mm-hmm. We focus on the parlor tricks because that's all he can do, though. He's not God. He doesn't have the privilege. God is able to create, use the Latin term ex nihilo. God is able to create out of nothing. We need, the rest of us need the stuff to make the other stuff from. God can create the stuff. And the evil one, he can't create the stuff. So what can he do? He tries to manipulate the physical. That's what he does to cause fear. The other is isolation. He strives to isolate us, to break down relationships, family relationships, spousal relationships, a whole host of relationships, because of course, when we're isolated, we're off by ourselves. And again, too, then he can work against us all the harder. But for those who are struggling with faith, I mean, it's almost, in some ways, it's almost a default setting for the evil one, you know, to come into play. He's going to try to throw that off completely. He's going to try to be the boogeyman that jumps out from behind the door, you know, and out of fear that, well, if I don't continue on this path of holiness, of renewal of my faith or whatever, he's going to leave me alone, kind of thing. So, I mean, you know, first of all, bless you for the work in offering retreats, but then to encourage all the more of those who have those obstacles to remain faithful, rooted, keep coming back kind of thing. But I mean, keep in the image of the evil one as a thug, as a bully. But for, I mean, my example earlier was a sense of those who are solidly grounded in faith. Again, even there's going to be bumps along the way, but he always comes to play at those who are seeking to find God, because he doesn't want anybody to find God. He doesn't know love. There's no love within him. That's the tragedy.
Yes, Father. I came across a motivational speaker stating that illness, accident, or even suicide are forces of evil, and death is one way of God's deliverance. How do you account for that?
So the question was that there are different things, like such as illness,
accident, or suicide.
I think it's, for me personally, it's, I think, a dangerous thing to generalize in those categories, because each case is unique, each situation is unique. You know, I mean, in a sense, there are situations, illness can be just illness. You know, I mean, in a sense, God created nature, he set the laws of nature in motion. People get sick, cancers happen, people die. It's not, you know, not perpetrated by the evil one, or maybe I'm misunderstanding what you're saying.
Well, my point is that when a person gets sick, and in order for God to take away that person away from our evil forces to get into that person, God would rather take it away. And
I don't know if that would reflect our theology, our Catholic theology. I mean, there's something at the root of it that bothers me, that in a sense, even like suicide, in a sense that God, you know, would allow suicide to be used as a means to remove somebody out of a more evil situation. Because, I mean, we know by and large, I mean, and again, the church herself looks to sciences, the advance of mental health sciences, all those kinds of things. And even, I mean, you know, there were years ago we would look at suicide, we wouldn't even allow somebody that committed suicide to be buried on hallowed ground. I mean, we're going back to the 30s and 40s years ago. Please correct me if I, at least it's my remembering. I remember my hometown outside of Madison, Wisconsin. There's the cemetery, there's the fence around it, and there's three or four graves in the far back corner. They were all suicides. You know, I mean, kind of, so it was such a different mentality back then, in a sense. But I mean, now, I mean, with the advances of mental health science, all the kind of things to say, there's something not functioning within that person that causes the suicide. You know, so I think we need to look at the whole picture in a healthy way, in a sense, I mean, accidents and the like. I guess I don't, my understanding of God is not that God functions and uses those kinds of things to work through. I mean, I believe things happen, accidents happen, tragically, yes. What can come from it? I mean, how can, in a sense, God's grace is at work, bring about conversion, bring about change. I don't know. Father John, is it? The whole question is just asking about things such as illness, accidents, suicide, as in a sense as God using those as a way of taking a person out of a situation that I mean are going to remove them from an evil situation or more influenced by evil. I don't think it flows from our theology. Yeah, I don't, and I can talk, I mean, just off the spot or off the cuff. That's, does that help a little bit?
Yes. So I'd like to make a statement about that. I work for a mental health provider, and we teach mental health first aid, and we also teach QPR, which is a suicide prevention training, to help people to learn the warning signs to how to help someone who is in crisis. And faith can be a very good thing for someone who is in crisis to help them to get better. I don't see it as evil. I think that sometimes life happens and things happen. With mental illness, you know, there is a biological component because there's the neurotransmitters in the brain are not functioning properly, but there's also trauma that happens to the person. And so by being able to have someone to, you know, getting them to the correct people that can help them, not just mental health professionals, but faith professionals, fitting some type of, that can be a benefit to that person. So in my personal interaction with that, I don't see it as evil. That's just my personal take.
Just to kind of add an environmental aspect, so maybe I still have Spruce disease, and one of the unfortunate side effects of Spruce disease is deep depression. So people who are suffering from a simple food disorder, if they would just not eat wheat, can come out of the depression. It doesn't take medication, it doesn't take counseling. Yeah. But unfortunately, people live in depression for most of their life because they're eating wheat every day and they don't realize it's poisoning their biochemistry.
Right.
So we can't always blame this on evil spirits.
Evil spirits.
Yeah, you can.
Yeah.
Yes.
I've worked both in mental health and also in spiritual guidance. And I've found that the body, mind, and spirit, those work together. Mm-hmm. And just to address Paul and say we've got to get mental health and not look at the spiritual world and what choices we're making, how that's affecting things, and how we take care of the body, which all brings these three things together. Really, it's like we heal, one arm, and we don't heal one arm, we're still lame. And so people have to see the whole picture and know that they need, we all need to be checking our physical health, our mental health, and our physical health all the time.
Well, and then,
right. Well,
I mean, and even, people that are coming that, feel like they're somehow demonically afflicted or whatever the case may be. It's not like, okay, we grab the calendar and next week, Tuesday, we'll schedule your exorcism. It's a matter of, okay, what's all going on? Everything from family of origin, history, mental health, physical health, spiritual health, other things, you open yourself, all these things. And it's always a matter of looking at the whole person, the holistic approach. Yeah, absolutely. Thank you. Are you done with me?
Turn to him and not to the distractions, not to the way, always not to the static.